Hey, welcome to everybody to today's associates meeting here at SIEPR. I understand that we are not conflicting with the president, who is apparently speaking in about an hour, so I'm relieved that that is true. We're very happy that you're here with us today, and I'm really looking forward to seeing many of you next week as well at our economic summit and at some of our other events in the spring. But right now, I'm thrilled and I'm truly honored to introduce you to our guest today, Esther George. Esther is the president and the chief executive officer of the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City, which is one of the nation's 12 Federal Reserve Banks. The Kansas City Fed oversees seven states. Ben, I just pulled this up. We can have a map. I just pasted this in before. So you can see there is the Kansas City Fed's region. I was curious because I didn't realize that Federal Reserve regions cut across states, but I was made curious when it covers Kansas, Nebraska, Oklahoma, Colorado, Wyoming, and also Western Missouri, as we can see right there, and Northern New Mexico. And as a native Missourian, I was wondering if she wanted to pull in all of Missouri into her region, and she said that she would happily do that. But she leads a staff of more than 1,600 employees in the bank's Kansas City office and the branch offices in Denver, Oklahoma City, and Omaha. So more than 1,600 people, and I thought that heading up SIEPR was hard, so her job is, we don't quite have 1,600. So it seems very impressive. Each of the 12 Federal Reserve Banks is responsible for gathering information on the economic conditions in its district. The information, which is culled from bank and branch directors and interviews with business leaders, economists, and other sources, goes into a report called the Beige Book, which is published eight times a year in advance of the Federal Open Market Committee meetings. And the next one is actually scheduled for release tomorrow, March 1st. So if you do not get enough today, you should go just Google Beige Book and you will be there, and there will be lots more information about the economy. So Esther and her colleagues, though, at the other Federal Reserve Banks really have their finger on the pulse of the nation's economy. And they're also responsible for supervising financial institutions and providing payment and financial services to depository institutions and the U.S. Treasury. Esther joined the Fed in 1982 and served much of her career in the Division of Supervision and Risk Management. She began by becoming a commissioned bank examiner and eventually served for 10 years as the district's chief regulator. In that capacity, she was responsible for oversight of the district's state chartered banks and nearly 1,000 bank and financial holding companies, as well as the bank's discount window and risk management functions. She's a former chair of the Federal Reserve System's Community Banking Organizations Managed Group, and she served as the acting director of the Fed's Division of Banking Supervision and Regulation at the Board of Governors at the Fed in DC. She hosts the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City's annual Jackson Hole Economic Symposium, and she's participated in the Bank for International Settlements financial stability programs in Lima, Abu Dhabi, Beijing, and Malaysia. Is that every place, or are there more? I don't know. It seems like a lot, but that's a lot of coverage. Earlier this month, just a few weeks ago, she was appointed to the Board of Trustees at the Kauffman Foundation, which supports research on improving the business climate for entrepreneurs in the U.S. Today, Esther will be drawing on her 35 years of experience as a bank supervisor and policymaker to give us her perspective on the U.S. economy and on monetary policy, and these insights will be much appreciated as so many of us are trying to predict and understand where the economy is headed with our new presidential administration. So with that, please join me in offering a warm welcome to Esther George to SIEPR.
Well, good afternoon, and I am delighted to be here today with all of you. SIEPR's is an important institution, I will tell you, as a policymaker. And I think never more than today, with the nature of the issues that the FOMC deals with, do we appreciate having a solid foundation of research and policy analysis to sort of help us frame issues, to guide us during what I think will prove to be some very uncertain times. Before I make my remarks, it's great to see many familiar faces here, but it's great to see a Kansas Cityan in the audience. One of the students here at Stanford, Mylon Gray. We know from Kansas City, and I understand you play an important leadership role with ASSU on the Senate. We're proud to hear that. Mylon is a graduate of a program we have at the Kansas City Fed called the Student Board of Directors. And it's a program that really aims to get high school students interested and informed about how the economy works, about their role in the economy. And he did so well on that program that we had him back for a couple of summers to run a program we call Summer at the Fed, where we bring in even younger kids. And he sort of rode herd on those kids and was our program activities director last year. So Mylon, it's great to see you here at Stanford. So this afternoon, here's what I think I'll do. I want to offer you just some brief thoughts on how I see the U.S. economy unfolding, talk a little bit about some of the challenges that my colleagues and I face in this environment. And then I'm going to share with you my own views on what I think is the most appropriate path forward for monetary policy. I will remind you the views I'm expressing are my own, as you know, and not necessarily those shared by others on the FOMC. So here we are, February 2017. This is the 92nd consecutive month of an expansion in the United States. This is the third longest expansion on record, going back to about 1850. Since the end of the financial crisis, the economy has grown annually by about 2% each year. Unemployment has declined, and labor markets appear to have only modest, if any, remaining slack in them. Inflation has been running at rates consistent with what I would call price stability, and near the FOMC's long-run target that it chose of 2%. And so while there are always some pockets of concern in the economy, I think on the whole that things look pretty positive here in the United States. Since the election in particular, we have seen optimism increase at a pretty hefty pace, both in surveys when we look at businesses as well as consumers. And consumer spending is expected to continue at a healthy pace. But that level of enthusiasm we see with consumers right now, I don't expect will automatically translate to even higher spending. The reason I think that is because the evidence suggests that consumer confidence is not always the most useful indicator of translating to consumption growth once you take into account where interest rates are and income growth. But still, I think we can't ignore the fact that household balance sheets are in much better shape compared to the years immediately following the crisis. And the labor market has been performing well, and the outlook remains positive, I think, for consumer spending. When you look at labor markets in this country today, I feel pretty safe in saying that we are essentially at or near full employment. The unemployment rate now sitting at about 4.8% is just below what I consider to be the long-run value of 5% for unemployment. Labor force participation, which has been trending downward for much of the expansion, has leveled off. We've even seen a slight uptick over the past year. Interesting, when you look at why the participation rate has popped back up a little bit, is that it looks to be due to a decline in labor force exits rather than an increase in people coming back into the workforce. So in other words, individuals are not more likely to return to the labor force right now, but workers are staying on the job a bit longer. And so my own assessment or sense of that is that there is not a lot of labor force slack, either among the officially unemployed or those that are out of the labor force who might rejoin. Of course, there are many, many indicators when you look at the job market. So trying to judge the amount of slack is really no straightforward task. One of the things we try to do at the Kansas City Fed is to really take a broad look at how that labor force is operating. And our staff has put together something we call a labor market condition index. It has some 24 different measures of the job market that we look at and really boil them down to two sort of succinct statistics. One that looks at the level of labor market activity and the other tries to measure momentum of that activity in the market. If you looked at January, which was our most recent survey of that level of activity, it was above its long-term average, and the momentum indicator is at the highest level since the series began in 1992. Another thing you will often look at to try to judge slack in the labor market is wage growth. And of course, wage growth has been quite moderate since the crisis, though it has increased over the past year. Despite improvement in overall wage growth, though, we know there are differences across sectors. Some of the research that my own staff has done shows that an increase in wages has been driven primarily by just a handful of industries, things like construction, manufacturing, wholesale sectors. Growth in hours worked in those sectors have sort of leveled out, wages have been rising, and those firms generally report that they are having a hard time attracting new workers for the positions they have. On the other hand, if you looked at wage growth in other sectors, particularly service sectors, you will see few signs of acceleration there, although we have seen hours worked begin to steadily pick up in that sector. So this suggests to me that there may have been a modest amount of slack in some of these service sectors, but as growth continues, I suspect workers will likely become increasingly scarce. This sort of bottoms-up approach evaluating the labor market suggests that we are likely to see further wage pressure across a broad sector of industries. So as labor markets continue to improve and economic activity expands, we would see a bit more inflationary pressure, I suspect. Currently, the FOMC's preferred measure of inflation, which is the PCE, or Personal Consumption Expenditures Index, has increased by 1.6% over the last 12 months, and this is up notably from where it was a year ago, when it was just at 0.6%. If you look past the effects of oil prices and just look at the core measures for inflation, you will see it's up 1.7% over the past year. And if you look more broadly at other metrics that try to capture what inflation's doing, CPI is around 2.5% today. If you look at some of the Fed, different Fed's measures, then they construct the Dallas Fed, the Cleveland Fed, you will see that those two are beginning to rise. So all of these measures are sort of pointing in the same direction, and that is inflation remains low, but it is rising. So with that as sort of the current state of the economy, clearly it stands in sharp contrast to the earlier phases of the recovery that we saw. Following the crisis, as you remember, the unemployment rate was persistently above its longer run level, and inflation was below what the FOMC had targeted for a long run rate. And at the risk of oversimplifying, I think you know the policy prescriptions for that kind of setting are pretty straightforward. That is, central banks normally apply monetary accommodation in support of economic activity so they can achieve their mandated objectives in that scenario. So the standard approach is basically you lower interest rates. And while the policy prescription in those circumstances is pretty straightforward, there are a few complications that policymakers have to wrestle with besides just lowering the interest rate. The first is one that's well understood, that monetary policy operates with lags. This is something that the FOMC points to each year in its annual statement of longer run goals and strategies, is to point this out, noting that the timing and the extent of any lags, of course, are imprecisely measured and can vary over time. And the reason I mention this is because these lags require monetary policy to act in a forward-looking manner. That is, policymakers cannot wait to take action until they see full employment and inflation at 2%. Policy needs to be adjusted in advance. The second complication I would note here is that following the crisis, policymakers became far more attuned to the connection between policy and financial stability. And while there is still a debate about what that relationship is, I think events that we've seen in the past and research still strongly suggest that risk-taking often increases in very low-rate environments. Indeed, the Fed's motivation for unconventional policies, such as large-scale asset purchases, were aimed at providing stimulus when interest rates were so low by encouraging risk-taking, creating wealth effects, and boosting asset values. And the third complication that I'll mention here is that policy needs to be set always with a sense of what are the risks that surround your outlook for the economy. The kinds of things that you've heard the FOMC talk about, things that are happening in foreign countries, things that are happening that cause financial market volatility, all can cause policy to sort of be put on hold or to pause momentarily. But even that pause creates and carries certain risk with it. Postponing rate adjustments, of course, isn't unreasonable in the face of those near-term risks, but it can keep policy stuck in place. And the resulting delay can leave a lasting imprint on the stance of monetary policy, especially if adjustments are not made after those risks pass. So why do I highlight this? Because, of course, policymakers always have to deal with these kinds of complications. One of the things that policymakers look to, though, in this kind of setting are monetary policy rules. And I'm sorry John Taylor isn't with us this evening, because you all know they are commonly referred to as Taylor rules. These rules give us guidelines for how to calibrate interest rates under most economic conditions. How the FOMC should use these rules, and this has been a topic of some discussion today from Congress to the more general public, is whether the Fed should adopt a rule or a set of rules to guide its policy. And in fact, what I tell people is the FOMC does use rules. We use them at every meeting. We have a sort of collection of them, and those rules come in many flavors. Their variables can be adjusted. The weights that you assign to the different variables, of course, can shift, and the designated value of what your long-run target is all influence the outcomes you get from those rules. So it makes picking a single rule very difficult. It would be difficult for the committee as a whole, I suspect, to agree on one, but that's not to suggest that they are not immensely useful to us. They may offer different advice, but when all of the advice moves in a particular direction, that is usually an important signal to policymakers. So again, with a variety of rules out there, the intuition behind them is relatively straightforward. Most of these rules take into account how far inflation is from whatever the designated target is, and how far labor markets are from full employment. And the deviation of those two things is accounted for then in the resulting rate prescription that they offer to you. On the other hand, when those variables are close to their longer run levels, these rules often prescribe that the federal funds rate or the short-term interest rate that the FOMC adjusts should be near or moving toward its longer run level. And in fact, today, most monetary policy rules are pointing in the same general direction and suggest our interest rates should be moving higher. Given these signals, it may be a bit surprising, though, that the FOMC has only raised its policy rate target twice in the last 10 years. So let me close with some thoughts on the path to this longer run rate. So again, these policy rules are pointing us in the direction of saying short-term rates should be higher. The FOMC has been clear that the path for raising those rates is going to be a gradual one. And a big part of the reason for that is one that I will call a risk management strategy. That moving too quickly could potentially risk slowing the economy. And of course, that is not an objective of policy, particularly today when the economy is growing at a relatively slow rate and inflation is low. And the other thing that I think the committee is sensitive to is a more rapid increase in short-term rates, of course, could pose risk to financial stability after there has been such an extended period of near zero interest rates. So as a member of the committee, I have supported this gradual approach. I think it is the right way to go about it. But my own view is that the current readings for inflation and unemployment relative to the FOMC's mandated objectives are arguing for more than just one move per year, as has been the case over the past few years. This pace, I think, has left monetary policy more accommodative than advocated by not only most of these policy rules, but it's left the Fed funds rate well below its longer run level, and that's a discrepancy that I see as important to remedy as we go forward, if we're to maintain steady growth in the economy. So in considering that path to what is a more normal interest rate, you will hear today people talking about whether monetary policy is in fact stimulative at all, given that these unusually low rates have not in fact generated the same kind of growth or inflation that we might have experienced in the past. One explanation is to say, well, certain features of our economy have changed, and that those changes are reflected in a measure that you will hear economists call a natural rate of interest. It is a rate of interest that is neither too tight nor too easy, and it lets the economy run sort of at a steady state. My own sense of that would be to say that if you looked at where that natural rate is today, that by historical standards, you might conclude the Federal Reserve doesn't have that many rate moves to make, and that that longer-term rate is lower than most of these policy rules would suggest. And the question is, what would have caused the economy to change? What would have changed that meant that we have lower long-term rates? Well, I suppose there are any number of reasons. One that I think is plausible is that productivity growth has not been as strong as it has in previous decades. And so slower productivity growth, which has been an ongoing issue for the US economy for some time, may be signaling that the supply side of the economy is growing more slowly. And as a result, this moderate growth that we've seen may in fact be enough to take up the slack in the economy and even cause the economy to sort of outrun what its potential would be. And in fact, I think you see that today, something that's called the output gap, which sort of tries to measure the level of economic activity relative to what we think its full potential is. I look at a measure that the San Francisco Fed puts out, and their sense of the current output gap and this natural rate of interest suggests that over the past few years, the economy has actually been growing higher than its potential, and that in these circumstances, that you might see it lead to price pressures and higher inflation. So if you pull all those pieces together, what is this long-term rate that the Fed might be shooting for, this path being very gradual, the question is, how should monetary policy respond in that kind of setting? And again, I will point back to some of these Taylor rules, which even under these conditions tell us that we should have a higher federal funds rate in the near term. And that's important so that economic activity does not get ahead of its potential capacity. And that's important, I think, because history tells us when we have waited too long, when we have allowed things to sort of overheat, the outcomes are not good for us. So my own view is that policy must still adjust, even if we accept that there could be a lower terminal rate for the federal funds rate, and move from its current settings if we are going to fulfill what is the mandate provided to us by Congress and the Federal Reserve Act. And I will tell you, it is often referred to as a dual mandate, but the actual words tell us our job is to promote the goals of maximum employment, stable prices, and moderate long-term interest rates. So while I agree that a gradual approach to moving these rates is going to be appropriate, I think that is clearly more than one move per year. And I think the outlook, as I judge it today, certainly does not call for tight policy. But on the other hand, I think we have to be deliberate and continue to adjust that rate as we see the economy unfold. So these are the nature of the issues that my colleagues and I will debate in a couple of weeks, as we have, it seems, for a number of years on these issues. And it promises to be a very rich discussion. So thank you very much for having me here. I look forward to your questions. So join me in here.
Thanks, that was great.
Thank you.
Hey, so we have a number of, well, John is 2,500 miles away in Washington, D.C. We have a number of strong macro economists here, so I'm going to try to get out of the way pretty quickly, but I have a couple of questions for you. So one thing, in addition to, you referred to the trajectory of interest rates, let's say over the past decade and how they've been at historically low levels, but there's also been this very large increase in the balance sheet that the Federal Reserve holds. Well, I just checked this out right before coming. Basically, we stood at about balance sheet of about $900 billion back about 9 years ago, and we're now at $4.5 trillion, so five times higher. And it's sort of gliding along. Mm-hmm. And there's some, I think, discussion about, or some questioning about, what is the right pace at which to unwind or sort of pull back on that balance sheet. And so I'm curious to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, so I talked a lot about the short-term interest rate. And clearly, the Federal Reserve took that rate down quickly in 2008 to zero. But the Fed then moved into what is commonly referred to as more unconventional tools, taking advantage of large-scale asset purchases or quantitative easing, which was the process of buying longer-term. So the short-term rate pinned at zero. The idea was we could influence longer-term rates more quickly by buying these longer-term bonds. And so, as you note, the balance sheet began to grow significantly, and today stands at $4.5 trillion. Every month, as those bonds mature and roll off, we are reinvesting to hold that constant. So in my own view, that is still providing some pressure on longer-term rates because of the size of that balance sheet and the activity of reinvesting. As early as 2011, you would have seen the FOMC talking about normalizing and talking about what to do with this balance sheet. The idea being, should we get back to a normal size balance sheet? Should we begin to sell assets? Would we let that happen more passively? In 2014, still talking about what to do with it. And at that time, the FOMC statement basically said, we'll address the balance sheet after those interest rate increases are well underway. Did not define well underway. We've not defined it yet today any more clearly. So a lot of questions are starting to come up. Now we've made two moves, and people are beginning to ask more questions. Are you well underway yet? Will you be at a higher rate before you address it? And I think even some are beginning to raise the question of, should you turn now to the balance sheet? So these are conversations that are very active for the committee to consider, is what is that relationship for that balance sheet as we go forward.
Okay, great, that's helpful. Now, another issue that come up is the, and this, not necessarily in the last week or so, but over the last several months, is whether and to what extent the Fed should pay attention to the stock market and just asset prices more generally.
If you're asking, pay attention to the weather.
All right.
That too.
Yeah, weather too. That would be good. Hasn't been so good around here, but anyway, that's. So I'm wondering, so if you look at, let's say, the S&P 500, it's up over 22% over the last year. And so that is, good in many ways, but it also, you hear some concerns about what I won't use the B word, but about what vulnerabilities and whether that is possibly at all driven by the low interest rates. So what's your sense of whether that should be a very much on the radar screen or simply focusing on the prices and the and output level, employment level?
So my observation is that over the course of this recovery, that we have seen asset prices outpace the growth in the economy generally. I think about the motivation behind asset purchases that the Fed made, that these large-scale asset purchases, it was pretty clear that they were aimed at increasing risk-taking, creating a sort of wealth effect. And I think in a number of cases you looked, for example, in my own region, pretty quickly after those actions, you began to see farmland values take off, moving well ahead of what commodity prices were high for a number of years, but moving quickly up. We saw stock values begin to move. You saw housing values. So there were certain asset classes that responded to both the low rates and, you know, sort of pushing risk taking out. Whether we have bubbles, and, you know, this is always the question. I really don't know anyone that's good at both timing and identification of those bubbles, and that's what makes it a challenge. So for me, the issue for the Federal Reserve is the conditions have been set. So low interest rates, having that large balance sheet, it puts a lot of pressure on regulators to sort of manage when do we see that tipping point. And I suspect as you begin to see rates rise, you should suspect some volatility from that.
Okay, great. So you mentioned it, just there in that last sentence, regulators. So next week we have this economic summit, and one of the sessions is going to be on Dodd-Frank. And so we're flying in some people to talk about Dodd-Frank, and we'll have debates on the pluses and minuses. So I'm curious, because you also, in addition to sort of looking out for monetary policy and how the economy is doing, have a lot of experience with supervision and regulation. So if you were to sort of, and there's a lot, it's a bit of activity in D.C. right now, centered around potentially changing some things in Dodd-Frank. So I'm curious, at a high level, are there certain things that you especially like in Dodd-Frank, and certain things that if you could, you'd pull them out, or would you just rip the whole thing out?
I won't win on answering that question.
Yeah.
So, when you think about what the crisis cost this country and cost workers, and it was costly. The preamble to Dodd-Frank was all about sort of ending too big to fail, trying to find a way that we could continue to benefit from the scale of these large institutions without putting taxpayers on the hook in the event that there was a failure. How would they fail? How would capital be calibrated? So the motivations for Dodd-Frank, I think, were clear. It had unintended consequences, as many times when you get these kinds of quick response to a bad situation. One of those consequences is that it has squeezed smaller banks considerably. And so the overlay of some of that regulation on the smallest institutions is actually sort of sped up consolidation, I think, of small institutions. And as I think it would be fair to say, we cannot point to say we've ended the risk of too big to fail yet. So however regulatory reform gets recalibrated, I think we should think about what the aims are and whether we have been focused enough on those things. Because if we don't have a safe financial system in this country, it will not serve us well in the long run.
Okay, great. All right, well, that's enough out of me, at least for a bit. Let me see if we have some questions from our audience here, back here at the back. Yeah, we got...
connection with the size of the balance sheet and reducing that, what about paying interest on excess reserves? Have you considered phasing that out?
So paying interest on excess reserves has become a fairly controversial tool. So this is something Congress allowed Early in the crisis, it was on the books, so to speak, in terms of being contemplated in legislation, because banks didn't want to hold reserves that they weren't compensated for. So the idea for interest on these reserves had sort of been thought about well ahead of this crisis. At the point that came in, the Federal Reserve looked at interest, paying interest on excess reserves as a way to help it control its interest rate structure. So today, it's serving, I would argue, an important role for us in terms of how we control interest rates. The Fed funds market is pretty thinly traded today. There's not much there. And so this sort of helps us anchor as we are moving rates forward. It has become in focus with proposed legislation. The question whether we should continue to pay this interest on the reserves. And I think for the Federal Reserve, it will mean thinking about longer term our monetary policy framework. How will we target interest rates, and how will we go about doing that if we don't have some of these tools? Both a function of the actions taken during the crisis, but the distance between that and where we ultimately might be is hard to see. So.
Great. Next question. Jennifer. Jen. Right up here. Thanks.
So we've heard recently from a number of policymakers, and you talked about this too, about how then we think that the natural rate of interest is actually lower now than it was previously, and especially with nominal interest rates being so low right now. Is there any concern among the FOMC that if we hit more recessions in the future, that it's more likely that we hit the zero lower bound?
Yeah, it's a big concern. The chair has been asked this in her testimony to Congress. You will see in the minutes of the FOMC a fair amount of discussion about what it means to be this close to the zero lower bound. This was one of the costs of the policy that the committee talked about early on, which is it's not free even when you go to free money, right? There are costs. And it's sort of been a double-edged sword for the committee. So there are some that would delay interest rate increases for the reason you said, and that is, boy, if I err on the side of moving too quickly and I cause the economy to slump, I don't have much capacity to use conventional tools. I'll be back adding to the balance sheet or talking in terms of using forward guidance to the economy. On the other hand, this is one of the risks, I think, that the committee faces, and that is you can sort of get paralyzed because how will you know that it's time to move? Some people are looking for inflation to get much higher or to see a tighter labor market. If you look at the projections that the committee members put out, they are showing that over the next 2 years there will be an undershoot in labor markets. That historically has not turned out well. Maybe this time will be different, but I wouldn't bet on it. So.
Okay. Another question back here, George. Here.
Is zero really a lower bound, though, on interest rates? Would the Fed ever consider negative interest rates in the future?
I was going to ask you that. Good. Thank you, George.
Yeah. So, again, if you look at the minutes of the discussion, I think for the Federal Reserve, we don't want to talk about negative interest rates. And it's been okay for us because our economy relative to most others has outperformed in a way that didn't make that imminent. My own views on this, as I've looked at what a quarter of the world's GDP coming out of countries that are using negative interest rates, I think I am not yet convinced this has been the cure that some central banks have looked for. Now, some countries have used this in a way that sort of helped with appreciation of their currency, and they were pretty deliberate about why they were doing it. Other countries using it in a more traditional way to stimulate. And I look at the effects on banking sectors, on insurance, I don't see yet, and I'm skeptical. Now, having said that, last summer, we talked about this at the Jackson Hole Symposium, and there were some that argued strongly that this is a tool worth looking at, but I have to tell you, I'm a skeptic.
Okay, additional questions? Professor Kleinow here, and then Daryl, and yeah. Oh, sorry, okay, sorry,
Yeah, kind of a follow-up on the last two questions, which is, should the Fed consider raising its inflation target to prevent running into the zero lower bound as frequently or having to contemplate negative nominal interest rates? Mm-hmm.
So I will just say it right. I'm not in favor of that. That has come up a lot, saying if we just had a higher target, that would cause what? What we want is the economy to grow in a sustainable fashion. And I get a little concerned when I hear people talk about welcoming inflation. So remember, I'm a child of the 80s. I went through that period, and I realize that's not what we're facing today. But the cost to people of inflation, we should not underestimate. So when we haggle over whether the 2% target is the point to hit, remember the error bands around that? And I think about people whose income is affected by inflation. So if you're a debtor, you don't mind if inflation gets high, but remember, people's standard of living is affected. So I'm very careful when I talk about what are the ways that central banks can sort of achieve 2% inflation, because you begin to multiply that over a period of time, and I think it carries its own costs. So not my preferred route.
Okay, we've got a couple of questions here, and then over here, and then, yeah. Like, so, Daryl, and yeah, next, great.
Thanks very much. You mentioned in your remarks that understanding why the natural rate, sometimes called R-star, is low is important in forming monetary policy looking forward. It's been coming down for a long, long time, maybe a quarter century. And you mentioned factor productivity has been going down. That's obviously part of it. I'm wondering if your bank or the FOMC also looks at demographic effects. We have a predictably changing demographic composition. Wealth concentration is spread quite unevenly within the retiring age cohort and across age cohorts, and that will continue in a way that, in principle, your research staff could maybe contribute somewhat to understanding how R-star is going to get formed into the future. Is that something that your bank or the FOMC looks into?
Now, I think increasingly, as we've gotten this far through the recovery of a long expansion, trying to explain these things has now shifted to more of those structural elements. So I should have mentioned productivity clearly, but I think demographics are an important issue. And this is one that I think we've underappreciated globally in terms of what it means. You can look at countries like Japan and see what it's meant there. And so when I see them taking steps to stimulate with negative interest rates and looking at the demographics there, it sort of makes you step back to say, we should be thinking about, we should be introspective about that. So I think it's a great idea, Daryl, in terms of making it part of a research agenda for policymakers to understand this. And I hope SIEPRs will look for ways
to
do this too.
Yeah. RAs are here, yeah. Okay.
Thank you for your remarks. I have a second R-star question for you, so but slightly different perspective, perhaps. So given the concerns about a falling R-star that was asked, it seems pretty important to understand why it's falling. And productivity was just mentioned, demographics were mentioned. J.P. Morgan had Investor Day, and Jamie Dimon offered a different perspective, which was that very, very high bank capital and regulation may have slowed the economy. Let's stipulate that we all agree there should be high capital. Is there a trade-off between high capital and even higher capital and R star? And therefore, how do you think, is the Fed or the Kansas City Fed thinking about how bank regulation affects R star and therefore the zero lower bound?
Mm-hmm. So it's a very good question. And I'll take it back for our staff to think about for the research agenda. But so here are the trade-offs, I think, in looking at this. First of all, I take note, and you and others think about R-star in terms of what it means, This is not observable. When things aren't observable and we sort of try to make a model of the economy, I think we have to be humble about what it is we are projecting or think that we can do here. As it relates to the capital, this is one I feel pretty strongly about because I don't think high levels of capital impede the investment process or the lending process. And I think the data is pretty clear. High capital provides sort of the wherewithal to do this and do it from a place of strength. And so I understand why banks who have levered up and have enjoyed returns on equity that historically have been very high, but that we saw in 2008 is very costly. So I think as a country, we sort of have to calibrate what our objectives are, but I don't think it's a trade-off between we can't have growth if we have safety. Is there a tipping point? There probably is with everything. You can take that too far, but I'd err on the side of safety, I think, in this case.
Him and then John. Yeah, here we go. Yeah.
Thank you. So in the lecture you mentioned about the interest will be increased in the near future. That seems to be a consensus among the Federal Reserve policymakers. Even they still have debate on the pace and the timing of the increase of the interest rate. So what are the implications for the exchange rate? So some people suggest that we'll enter a strong dollar period. That's the case. What are your thoughts on that? Thank you.
So indeed, we have seen in the United States the dollar has been pretty strong, and we've seen it move up. To the extent that what the FOMC is looking at is how does that tighten financial conditions? How does that interact with our decisions around interest rate increases? I don't think that can become our policy objective, though, because as we are beginning to normalize and set that, you should see that sort of be reflected in the strength of the economy. And the truth is, the U.S. economy, both given its size and given its relative performance, has contributed to this exchange rate phenomenon where you see the strong dollar effects there. So yes, it's something the committee thinks about, tries to understand. I hear this from businesses in my region. So when they hear me advocating for some normalization of interest rates and they're in a manufacturing business where the strong dollar has affected them, we know particular segments are particularly affected by that. But again, in the long run, and that is the hardest thing, I think, in my own experience on this committee, is trying to take in what you see today, but to remember you are making decisions for the long run, and that can require some courage in doing that and making some assumptions about what can I look through and what do I need to react to today. So that's one of them.
Okay, John, and then we've got a few. Yeah, John. And I've got to look over here, too. I haven't looked over. Okay, yeah. Got a lot of questions. Okay. John, yeah.
So first, I want to thank you for that endorsement of high capital, something we all love around here. Don't give in to the pressure. But I want to ask you two questions, and you can answer whatever of it you find interesting in here. The first is, I was interested to hear you say that monetary policy properly did boost asset values. Of course, if a stabilizer sometimes wants to boost asset values, sometimes it wants to lower asset values, which will be a lot less popular with the American public. And which relates to not just monetary policy, I'm curious on your views of the macroprudential project. Almost the majority of what the Fed does now is to be the great regulator. And the one version of the project says diagnose bubbles or whatever, but use not just interest rate tools, but use your regulation tools to achieve monetary policy objectives. If they're lending too much money to houses in Palo Alto, you just go to the banks and say, stop lending so much, which will also be unpopular. And that segues into sort of the second question, which is related, the popularity question. There's a lot of rumbling in Congress that's unhappy about the Fed. If you were to sharply raise interest rates this spring, I'll call this the elephant in the room question. Congress might be unhappy, and Congress is the friendly person in the other part of Washington, D.C. It would take great courage and faith in the Fed's continued independence to do something like that. And if you feel like commenting on how those things affect your thinking, that would be interesting too.
Yeah. Well, those are two big questions, for sure. Let me just start with the second one. I'll move back to the macroprudential's role in this. So I think it's not debatable that you want a central bank that is independent and is apolitical. And that doesn't mean that you won't get backlash for those decisions. And it's one of the reasons, in fact, in 2013, when I dissented against QE3 and some of those policies, not because I didn't understand the motivation for them, but because my own sense was this is pushing in a direction that when I judged the cost benefit, the benefit was pretty near term to the extent you can measure it, but it's so easy to ignore the cost, right? When something's in front of you to understand, and we could enunciate the cost, but they seemed far into the future. So when I look at where we sit today, I worry a little bit about what it means to begin this process of moving rates up, because you can't assume, as much as the committee will try for this soft landing, smooth transition back to normal, this has been an extraordinary period of doing things that we think we understand, right? Short-term interest rates, but also doing things that we do not have experience with. And these unconventional policies, I think for many years to come, we will be diagnosing as well as dealing with that. So yes, courage to move ahead, but this is essential for a central bank to sort of, when the politics around you are the most heated, you have to move in the direction of what your mandate is. On the macroprudential, I will just tell you, I think in some sense we've always done macroprudential, but now we've brought it to a point to say there are certain levers that we can pull. And I don't know what those are. I hear about this, it's studied heavily, we talk about it, but I'll give you an example. Going back to the early 2000s, when we began to see commercial real estate concentrations growing in the economy, and of course this was at the time that new mortgage products were coming along, regulators saw this concentration building and began to draft guidance. It wasn't a hard rule. It was sort of guidance to say we need to put this out and tell the banks slow down on these concentrations or have very strong capital and risk management that goes along with it if you're in that business. Once those guidelines hit in 2006, there was a huge backlash. More than 4,000 comment letters, and Congress came back saying, what do you think you're doing? The economy's going good. You're trying to turn this spigot off, you need to back off. And so it was too late by then anyway, once the guidance came out. So I am leery of macroprudential in that sense. I think it takes sort of more durable features like capital with a supervisory process that is firm but fair. And I know that sounds pretty judgmental, but I don't think you can calibrate this otherwise and get the outcomes you want.
And Mr. Gunn.
You referenced the dual mandate.
Yes.
Okay, imagine your job where you only have one mandate, and that's to keep inflation low in the future and stable. Would that change a lot, what you do?
So I'm skeptical it would change a lot. Sometimes I have been inclined myself to say, gee, if we just focused on inflation, that might be the better part of this. Many other countries, central banks only have this sort of singular mandate. But I think even in those cases, you will find those central banks are also factoring in what's happening in the health of our job market, because that, of course, is tying in to spending and other aspects of health. So, it may sound simpler to go with one target, but even if you think about it today, so with inflation relatively low, I would argue that we would be perhaps ignoring the signal of labor markets tightening, and and maybe continuing on a path that would not be looking toward that sustained growth. That's why when I go back, for a long time, I didn't like using the word dual mandate because it sort of sounded like you have these two things at the exclusion of all else. And actually, when you read what the law tells us to do, and that's why I bring it up, it's not a dual mandate. It sort of points us to the long run and said your job is to try to do what you can to promote full employment and price stability, but in a way that promotes long-run sustained growth. So any of these things that can't be sustained in the long run, I think is what can trip up policymakers in thinking about what today's actions mean for the long run. So.
Okay, we're coming close on time. I'm gonna try to get a couple more. Eric?
So with the change in administration, how would you think about changes in fiscal policy, repatriation of capital, immigration, things like that, how they might impact or the way the Fed would think about action in the future?
That's a very good question. You'll notice I didn't talk about that in my own sort of outlook for the economy. It's a very important issue for us. So we know that fiscal policies can have a big impact for the economy. And what is difficult today for me, for many of my colleagues, I think, is judging what is the forecast and how can you build it in when you do not know today exactly what those policies are going to be. So we see the markets, we see consumer and business sentiment sort of taking off. And in fact, in my own region, as I talk to people, it's not just a hope. Some of them are starting to loosen up the purse strings and saying, I'm investing now. I think the question is toward one end. So where will these other economic levers be pulled? Will it be around tax policy? Will it be a trade issue? Which again, some of these are slow moving. Some of those can have sort of a negative feedback depending on how they're calibrated. So I don't know how to answer your question very clearly because I don't know exactly what the policy is. And maybe in a little bit we'll hear more about what those could be, but watching very carefully. So for my own outlook, so my baseline, you heard me say kind of where I think things should go, I see this as an upside risk in many respects to that growth outlook.
So. That's great. I'm sorry, I know I'm not going to get to answer, but John Chauvin, I'm going to let him get the last question in. So I'm sorry for those, the great, you great answers. So
I was just going to ask you about last year in some sense. Last year the economy grew at 1.6% and labor markets tightened. So how fast do you think the economy grows? How fast is the potential growing? Presumably it's slower than 1.6%. Is that right?
Well, the economy, it has been growing about 2% a year. And I mentioned the piece from the San Francisco Fed, which is sort of estimating it may be growing past what its potential is. So 1.75 maybe is what we would consider to be the potential for the economy right now. So some of these forecasts that suggest we could get 3%, we could get higher growth in the economy, it's going to be a challenge. Our labor markets are not growing that fast. And we talked about productivity, which is can be sort of slower moving. It's hard to see how these things might boost that trajectory going forward. But
okay, well, I think we should wrap up there. I'm very sorry, but thanks to Esther George.